Good morning one and all. So let us start today's class with a problem. So please read the problem carefully. Now the problem says a teacher often has her facts wrong and answers each of her students questions incorrectly with a probability 1/4. Incorrectly means wrongly. Wrongly with the probability how much? 1/4. Correctly with the probability how much? 3/4. Independent of other questions. Okay, in each lecture the teacher is asked 0 questions, or which means no questions are asked. They may ask one question or students may ask 2 questions with equal probability, means 1/3. Okay, so for this scenario let us find out the joint PMF. First of all let us find out what is joint PMF. Okay, in this problem we have 2 random variables. What are they? Let me call x and y. What is x, what is y? X is number of questions asked, that is random, number of questions asked by the students. Now what is x? Now the students are asking 0 questions or no questions are asked. They may ask one question, they may ask 2 questions. Now what is y? Is another random variable where so the teacher may give wrong answers. Okay, wrong answers or correct answers. So let us call y as number of questions answered wrongly. Y is nothing but, so let me take another. So x is number of questions asked, number of questions asked . So x can take on what values? 0, 1, 2. What is y? Number of questions answered wrongly. Okay. So it depends upon x actually. Okay. So let us see how to construct a sequential description of the above problem. Okay, now so this is the sequential description of the above problem. Okay, now we start from here. Okay, now here so wrong answer is 1/4, probability of answering wrongly is 1/4, correctly is 3/4. Okay. Now so here, now x is a random variable which is defined as number of questions asked. Y is another random variable which is defined as number of questions answered wrongly. Okay, now let us define x. Now so students may ask 0 questions, 1 question, 2 questions with the probability 1/3, equal probability, that is 1/3. Okay, next. So here the probability is 16/48, which is also equal to 1/3. Okay, now here, so since students did not ask any question to the teacher, so there is no point of giving wrong answers or correct answers because students did not ask any questions at all. Okay, so it stops here. Now so let us go here, this case 2. Now how many questions are asked? Only one question. Now here there are 2 possibilities. What are they? Teacher may give correct answer or wrong answer. So what the probability of giving correct answer? 3/4. Wrong answer? 1/4. Okay, now here, so here what do you mean by here at this point? What do we get here? Something like this. So students are asking one question to the teacher and teacher gave correct answer. Okay, how to find this probability? Multiply these two, means 1/4 into 3/4, that is 1/12. So 1/12 is 1/3 into 3/4, which means that is 1/4. which is same as 12 by 48. Okay. Now what does at this point, what do we get? So students are asking one question, teacher give wrong answer to that question. Means, so this is 1 by 4 into 1 by 3, 1 by 12, which is same as 4 by 48. Okay. Now, here, now let us go to this case. Here, what happened here? Students are asking two questions to the teacher. What may happen? Three cases may happen. So here, what may happen? Three cases may happen. So here, teacher may give two wrong answers, which means students are asking two questions, teacher gave two wrong answers to those two questions. What a probability? So probability of wrong answer is 1 by 4. So teacher is giving two wrong answers, which means 1 by 4 into 1 by 4, that is 1 by 16. Now at this point, at this branch, what do we get? So teacher, two students are asking two questions, teacher gave two wrong answers. What the probability? So 1 by 16 into 1 by 3, so 1 by 48. Okay. Now here this case, so let me write very clearly. So let us go to this case. 1 means, what do you mean by that? So here they are asking two questions, teacher gave one wrong answer, which means one correct answer. Okay. Now there are two possibilities. What may happen? So first question may be correct answered, second may be wrong answered. Otherwise reverse may happen. First question answered wrongly, second question answered correctly. Now what the probability? Now correct probability 3 by 4, so 3 by 4 into 1 by 4. Reverse may happen, that is 1 by 4 into 3 by 4. What the probability? 3 by 16 plus 3 by 16, 6 by 16. Now at this point, what do you get? So students are asking two questions, teacher gave one wrong answer, one correct answer. The probability is 1 by 3 into 6 by 16. What is that? 6 by 48. This is 6 by 48. Okay. Now, so what is this case? What do you mean by this? So students are asking two questions, teacher gave two correct answers. So what is the probability of giving two correct answers? 3 by 4 into 3 by 4, that is 9 by 16. So at this point, what the probability is now? 1 by 3 into 3 by 4 into 3 by 4, which means, so 1 by 3 into 9 by 16, that is 9 by 48. This is the probability 9 by 48. Now, so here we got all joint PMFs. So, okay, so let us summarize them. So let us draw the table for joint PMF. Okay, here, so this is X. What is X? Number of questions asked, 0, 1, 2. What is Y? Number of questions answered wrongly, it is also 0, 1, 2. Now what do you mean, what did this box represents? No questions asked, no answer, no wrong answers is given. What is that probability? What is the probability? No questions asked, no wrong answers is given. 16 by 48. So let me write here, that is 16 by 48. What is this? One question asked, 0 questions answered wrongly. One question asked, 0 question answer wrongly. What is the probability? 12 by 48. That is 12 by 48. Two questions asked, 0 questions answer wrongly. That is 9 by 48. So from that sequential description, you can fill all the blanks in the 4 by 48. This is 6 by 48. This is 1 by 48. Now we have filled only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 boxes. Why? Here we had only 6 probabilities. What are they? So only 6 probabilities we can be able to find out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But here we had how many probabilities? 9 probabilities. Okay, what about this? Here, what do you mean by this? So let us study this. So 0 questions asked, 1 wrong answer is given. Is it possible? Students did not ask any questions, then how come teacher will give wrong answer? That is impossible event. Do you agree or not? Okay, so this is 0. It won't happen because, so if no questions are asked, how come student, how come teacher will give wrong answer? Okay, that is not possible. Impossible event. Here, what has happened? So number of questions asked are 1, but what do you mean by this? Teacher gave 2 wrong answers. How it is possible? It is also not possible. Here, no questions asked, but teacher gave 2 wrong answers. It is also not possible. So remaining are zeros, impossible events. Now this is the joint PMF. Now, so suppose if I ask you, what is P, X, Y of 1, 2? What is the answer? 1, 2. 1, X1, Y2, that is 0. Suppose if I ask you, P, X, Y of 2, 2. What a probability? 2, 2. What is that? 1/48. 1/48. So this is the, what is this? This is joint PMF. What is this? This is the joint PMF. Now, so let us go to the question. What did they ask in the question? So, find the probability that at least 1 wrong answer. What is asking? Find the probability that at least 1 wrong answer. Find out. How will you find out? Find the probability that at least 1 wrong answer. Now, so here, so let us write here the next page. At least 1 wrong answer. At least 1 wrong answer. Now, so how to find out at least 1 wrong answer? P, X, Y of, which means 1 question asked, 1 wrong answer is given. That is one possibility. Next, P, X, Y of 2 questions asked, 1 wrong answer is given. Correct? Plus another possibility is P, X, Y of 2 questions asked, 2 wrong answers given. Here, so 1 wrong answer, 1 wrong answer, 2 wrong answers. How many questions asked? 1 question, 2 questions, 2 questions. Now if you find out all these things, it is 4/48 plus 6/48. It is from the above table. 1/48. Total how much? 11/48. This is the probability. Okay. Now not only this, you can find out any probabilities because you know the table. So if you find out marginal PMFs also. Can you find out marginal PMFs? I told you. What we do? You add all the columns and all the rows. You get marginal PMFs also. You do it. Okay. So that is about marginal PMFs and the table, right? Now, so let us move on to another topic, that is called conditional expectation. We know what is expectation. Now we are discussing conditional expectation. Okay. Yeah, all probabilities and PMFs are replaced by their conditional counterparts. Okay, so already we discussed conditional PMFs, all those things. Okay, now how it is defined? So if I write expectation of X, it is unconditional expectation. What it is called? Unconditional. If I write expectation of X given A, it is called condition on what? on event A. Okay. So the conditional expectation of x given in event A. Now, so I told you so many times, nothing to worry about conditional probabilities, conditional PMFs. Okay. Now let me write expectation of x formula. What is the formula? Summation over x, x into px of x. Now I am asking, what is the expectation of x on a condition A? X given a condition A. Then what do you write? Summation over x, x into p x given A of x. So what we have done? What we have done here? So we have replaced PMF with what? Conditional PMF. That is the only difference, right? Everything remains same. So that's why I told you in the starting itself here, I mentioned all the probabilities and PMFs are replaced by what? Conditional counterparts. Okay. Now, so conditional expectation of x given a value y of y is defined by something like this. Okay. Now, so here, let us discuss conditional expectation on a random variable. Okay. Now what is defined? Expectation of x given y equal to small y. Okay. Now what do you write? So again, summation over x, x into p x given y of x given y. Now this is again conditional PMF. Now it is condition on what? Another random variable. In the last class, I have discussed two types of conditions. One is condition on event. Next, condition on another random variable. Okay. I hope you remember those things. If you remember those things, it is very, very easy. Just replacing them. Nothing more than that. Okay. Now here comes the one of the important theorems, that is called total expectation theorem. So before going further, so let me recall total probability theorem. What it says? It just exactly similar to the total probability theorem. What it says? Probability of B equal to probability of A into, sorry, probability of A1 into probability of B given A1 plus probability of A2 into probability of B given A2, so on. Where A1, A2, AN are form a disjoint, they are disjoint and they are the partitions of the sample space, where B is any other event. I hope you remember this. If you don't remember, you just recall it from the previous classes. Okay. In the same way, we am writing total expectation theorem. Based on what? Total probability theorem. Now what I am writing? So expectation of x equal to summation of I equal to 1 to n p of a I expectation of x given a I. P of a I is always positive, it is non-zero. Okay. So let me write here. So having seen this, so let me write expectation of x. It is called total probability theorem. That is, what I can write is p of a1 into p of a1 into expectation of x given a1 plus p of a2 into expectation of x given a2, so on, plus, so on. Finally, I can write expectation of x given an. Okay. Now exactly same thing is being written here. Okay. A1, A2, AN, BD disjoint set. They form a partition of a sample space. Now they are written in the form of summation. So let us write in the form of summation. Now what will happen? what will happen? Expectation of x equal to summation over I equal to 1 to n p of ai into expectation of x given ai. That's it. But so one thing to be remembered is here we are writing, this is what called as unconditional expectation. Unconditional expectation. Well, this is called conditional mean or expectation. Now, using this total probability theorem, we are writing unconditional mean in the form of what? Conditional mean. Okay. So the basis for this is, what is the basis for this? Total probability theorem, which we discuss in the starting classes. Okay. So if you don't remember, just go and listen to those classes. Okay. Now, so there are two types of conditional expectations. One is condition based on event. One is condition based on another random variable. Just like the conditional PMF. Okay. Now, here comes the another important aspect of a random variable. That is independence of a random variable from an event. Here also we start with an event, from an event. Okay. Here, so let me recall all those independence things which we have discussed for probabilities. So let me call A and B are events. Now, when can you say they are independent? We say they're independent if probability of A intersection B is same as probability of A into probability of B. Okay. Or other words, probability of A given B equal to probability of A. Or B given A equal to probability of B. Okay. Then they are said to be independent. Isn't it? Now, so same concept will be used here also. No change at all. There may be change in the notations, not in the concepts. Okay. Now, for example, what do you mean by independence? Okay. Suppose A, let me take an event. That is, let us take bone fracture. B is another event, that is blood test. Okay. Now, so if you observe these two events, are they independent? Yes, they are independent. Why? Because how can you say like that? Why? Because so to identify bone fracture, generally what we do, we should go for x-ray or any kind of scanning. Okay. Here we cannot identify bone fracture by conducting a blood test. Okay. Suppose you have something like this, probability that identifying a bone fracture by conducting a blood test. Okay. So here, this is not useful for us because to identify a bone fracture of our body, we should go for a scanning or x-ray. Okay. Now, our simple medical knowledge says that these two are independent events. Okay. Because, so blood test is not useful to us to identify the bone fracture. Isn't it? Okay. Now, these two are independent events. Now, it is same as probability of identifying only bone fracture. Because this blood test doesn't give any information to us. It is not useful information for us in this example at least. Okay. Now they are said to be independent events. Now, so here we are discussing independence of what? Not events, independent of random variable on an event. Okay. Now, so let us study them in detail. Now here, so as I just now mentioned, so let us study right, x is independent of event A if what there is writing, if p of x given A of x equal to p x of x for all x. Okay, now what we write in case of events, p of A given B equal to p of A. Same thing is being written here, the notations are different, nothing more than that. Okay, now how to prove this. Okay, so let us go with the proof. Now here, so random variable x and event A are said to be independent if their conditional PMF P of x given A of x is equal to its PMF of x. Okay, so before proceeding further, let me recall the formula of x given A of x. What is that? I told in the last class. What do you write? Probability that capital X equal to X and or intersection A by probability of A. Isn't it? This is the formula of conditional PMF of an event. Are you with me or not? So let me go back to the two events. Another definition of independence is A intersection B equal to P of A into P of B. That is also definition of independence of two events, not random variables. Now, if it is so, what we can do? So let me take the numerator here, this numerator, probability of x equal to x and A. Okay, can be written as probability of x equal to x into probability of A. Just like we have written like this. Okay, so here I have written probability of A intersection B equal to probability of A into probability of B. In the same way I have written for this. Probability of x equal to x intersection A equal to probability of x equal to x into probability of A, which means, so in this expression, the numerator can be written as, how can be written as? Probability of x equal to x into probability of A by, so denominator is probability of A. Then these two will be cancels out. We are left with probability of x equal to x. What is this equal to? Probability of x equal to what? X equal to small x equal to, what is that? PMF. So hence it is proved that, so conditional PMF of x given in event A of x equal to px of x for all x, then x and A are said to be what? Independent. Or you can also write like this. Probability of x equal to x and A equal to probability of equal to px of x into P of A for all x. These are the two definitions of independence of a random variable on an event. Both are correct. Just like we have two definitions for independence of two events. What are they? So let me write briefly here. So probability of A intersection B equal to probability of A into probability of B. And one more definition is probability of A given B equal to probability of A. So just like these two, we have these two. Okay. Now, so let us take a problem. Consider two independent tosses of a fair coin. Let X be the number of heads and A be an event, that number of heads is even. X and A are independent or not. You have to find out whether X and A are independent or not. So let us read the question properly one more time. Consider two independent tosses of a fair coin. Let X be the number, X is a random variable, that is number of heads, and A be the event, that the number of heads is even. Okay. Okay. So let us solve this. Now, so here, now A is, okay, first of all, what is sample space? We are tossing two coins, right? What is experiment first of all? The experiment is tossing two coins. So the experiment is tossing two coins, tossing two fair coins. So what a sample space would be? Two heads, two tails, head tail, tail head, four elements in the sample space. Now what is the random variable X? X is a random variable which is defined as number of heads in the outcome. Okay. Now, so what are the probability values of X? How many heads you can get? Looking at this sample space, here you are getting two heads, here one head, here one head, here how many heads? Sorry. Here two heads, here how many heads? Zero heads, both are tails. Here one head, here also one head. Now the possible values of X are 0, 1, 2. Okay. This is a random variable which can take on 0, 1, 2. What is event A? Number of heads are even. Should get even number of heads. Okay. First of all, so let us write the how to check independence. Okay, so we have to verify two things. What are they? So P of X given A of X, you have to find out this one, and P X of X. If these two are equal, they are independent. If not equal, they are not independent. Okay. Now, so what is this? This is a conditional PMF. What is this? Is normal PMF or marginal PMF, or simply you can call PMF. So let us find out Px of X. What do you mean by that? How to find Px of X? How to find Px of X? Okay. Now, so let us take one more paper. Okay. So let me write here. Head, tail, tail head, tail tail. So here Px of 0, which means probability that X equal to 0, which means what is X now? Number of heads, which means so the probability of getting 0 heads. What is the probability getting 0 heads? Means TT. Okay, so 1 among 4, that is 1 by 4. Okay. Now what is Px of 1? That is probability that X equal to 1, which means probability that the number of heads are 1. Means what are the possibilities? HT, TH. There are two possibilities out of 4. That is 1 by 2. Now what is Px of 2? That equal to probability that the number of heads are equal to 2. Number of heads are 2. Only this is a possibility. 1 among 4. So that is again 1 by 4. Now here, so the PMF of X is, how can you write? Px of X equal to, what do you write now? It is 1 by 4 if X equal to 0. It is 1 by 2 if X equal to 1. Again 1 by 4 for X equal to 2. Okay, so this is over. Next, we have to find out what p of x given a of x. P of x given a of x. So let me recall this definition. This is a conditional PMF. How to write this? P of x equal to small x and a by P of a. Okay. Now before that, so first of all, we should know what is a event. What is a event? That is number of heads are even. How many possibilities? Getting even number of heads. So in the sample space, we have four possibilities: head, head tail, tail head, tail tail. So event A consists of how many elements? Getting even number of heads means 2 heads or 0 heads. Here we are getting 2 heads or 0 heads. Both are even numbers. So what is the probability of A now? So the number of elements in A are 2 out of 4 means 1 by 2. Now here we have to find out. So let me write here one more time. P of x given A of x equal to P of x equal to x intersection, I can write as intersection A by P of A, isn't it? Now, so let me take x equal to 0, P of x given A of 0, small x equal to 0, which means probability that x equal to 0 intersection A. By P of A. Now here, so x equal to 0 means getting 0 heads. Now how many such things are possible? Okay, can you find out how many such things are possible? P of x equal to 0 intersection A. We have to find out this probability. What is that? What is that? So x equal to 0 means what? Number of heads are 0. Correct? What is that possibility? What is the possibility? It implies tail tail. What is event S? Yes. Even number of heads. HH tail tail. Now what is x equal to 0 intersection A? Tail tail. Okay, so that is 1 by 4. What is the probability? 1 by 4. Is it okay? So x equal to 0 intersection A has got only one element, that is tail tail. Okay, now this probability is what? What is this probability? 1 by 4. So what is this probability now? So P of x given A of 0 equal to 1 by 4 by 1 by 2, that is 2 by 4 again 1 by 2, for x equal to 0. Correct? For x equal to 1. So P of x given A of 1, which means probability that capital X equal to 1 intersection A by P of A. X equal to 1 means what? Getting only one head. What are the possibilities? Getting one head means HT TH. Now event A is getting even number of heads, which means head or tail tail. So what intersection between these two? No common elements. So obviously probability of this will be 0 by 1 by 2, that equal to 0. Do you agree or not? Here x equal to 1 has elements HTTH. A has got element HHTT. So they don't have any common elements. So that's why. So the numerator of this will be 0. Obviously, answer will be 0. Now, P of x given A of 2, which means probability that x equal to 2 intersection A by probability of A. X equal to 2 means getting 2 heads. What are the possibilities? Headed. Event A, getting even number of heads. Head head, tail tail. So what intersection? How many elements are there? HH. Out of 4. Okay. Now that's why the probability will be 1 by 4 by P of A. What is P of A? Again 1 by 2. So this is also equal to 1 by 2. Now, so let me write this conditional PMF. P of x given A of x equal to 1 by 2 for x equal to 0. 0 for x equal to 1. Again 1 by 2 for x equal to 2. This is the conditional PMF. Okay. Now what is the px of x? Let me write one more time for you. Px of x equal to, it is 1 by 4 for x equal to 0. It is 1 by 2 for x equal to 1. It is again 1 by 4 for x equal to 2. So these are the two PMFs we got. So this is the conditional PMF. This is the normal PMF. Are they equal? If x equal to 0, it is 1 by 4, it is 1 by 2. If x equal to 1, it is 0, it is 1 by 2. So they are not equal. Which means, what we can say finally? So P of x given A of x is not equal to Px of x for all x. Hence, they are not independent. Had it been equal, they would have been independent. Okay, so that is about finding the independence of a random variable on an event. Okay, so we stop here. So we continue in the next class. Thank you.